folks, this is Pastor Mike Hoggard coming to you from Watchman Studios with another Watchman video broadcast. This is part two of us looking at the gospel in our blood. And I mean what I say. We started out last week. And we talked about just the types of blood. There are four gospel writers in your Bible, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And then you have just happen to have four blood types. And nobody knows why. Nobody knows why in human blood there's differences, and if you have B positive blood, you can't have A negative blood coming into you. That's like they don't get along, all right? But we have A, B, AB. A can donate to A, B can donate to B, A can donate to AB, B can donate to AB. But if you want one donating to everybody, you go with O. So out of the four, O is different than the rest of the three. That's the way it is in the gospel books. Matthew, Mark, Luke are synoptic gospels, but John is different than the other three. You even have that, and we're going to get into DNA, in the four base pairs that join DNA together. You have adenine, thymine, guanine, and cytosine. And adenine, guanine, and cytosine are the ones that are present in RNA and DNA as well. RNA is single strand, DNA is double strand. But in RNA, the single strand, you have adenine, guanine, cytosine, and uracil. For some reason, when that RNA joins to another strand or makes that other strand, uracil is taken out and thymine replaces it. And I'll give you a little something. So thymine's different. It's just like the Gospel of John. Think of this. We are composed of spirit, soul, and body. But we're going to die one of these days. And that body's going to go in the ground. Paul said, the Bible teaches us, that when that happens on Resurrection Day, we're going to get new body. Four. It's going to be different than the other body, the third part. Think of Jesus in the fiery furnace with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. There's those three in there. Nebuchadnezzar put them in there. The fourth one is different. He's the Son of God. I don't want to spend too much time on that because we dealt with it last week. But to me, it's fascinating. Because you're seeing the gospel even in the four blood types and the doctrine of Christ giving his blood for everybody so that they could live. And that's what a donor is. He's giving his blood to somebody else so they don't die, so they can live. So we talked about the four blood types. We talked about the fact that the blood system contains plasma. 55% of your blood volume is plasma. 95% of plasma is water. So somewhere just over half of your entire bloodstream is water. And it looks like the veins and the capillaries look like a river system, and that we have the river head in Eden, and it came out into four parts. That's the four chambers of the heart. And one of those chambers is different because in one chamber you have blood coming in from the body. It then puts it to the second chamber, which sends that blood to the lungs, and we're going to learn this, so the lungs can get rid of that carbon and all that stuff that's in there. And then it replaces it with oxygen, which goes into the third chamber of the heart. The third chamber pulls it in from the lungs, but that fourth chamber is different because it's the one that gives life again to the body, because it takes that oxygenated blood and distributes it to the whole body. All right? See how wonderful this is? See how the gospel is in our blood, it's in our heart, it's in our bodies, it's in our DNA. Everything that God made in us is a testimony to the gospels. So we learned that last week. Now we're going to get into the two other parts of it. Actually, there's four parts that we're dealing with. Think about that. We're going to look at red blood cells, white blood cells, and then platelets. So let's begin looking at red blood cells. I noted last week, if you take a look at this picture, you have red blood cells and white blood cells. Why do we have those? The Bible equates blood with wine. Jesus said, Mark 14, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, and they all drank of it. And he said unto them, this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many. Notice, red blood cells, white blood cells, red wine, white wine. God made wine, fruit of the vine, grape juice. He made it just like the types of blood cells that we have. And all of that, the red blood cells, we're going to learn red blood cells today. The red blood cells and the white blood cells specifically carry the design of its maker in there to show forth how the gospel works. And again, we're looking at things now that we know, knowledge about blood that at best 100, 150 years old. For thousands of years, man didn't know this, but what the writers of the Bible were writing down in the Word of God, preserved for us today, so that now when this, as this knowledge is being increased, and it is, we're now able to see inside of things that no man has ever seen before, and we're looking at this, and I'm looking at it, and I'm going, this is that which was spoken by the prophets, all right? So let's understand, we know how important blood is to the body. Let's understand how important blood is to the life of a believer, because there are denominations, there are the exalted scholars. And I had a run-in with this doctrinal error several years ago. The doctrinal error is that certain people, certain of the esteemed Greek scholars, no longer believe that the blood is necessary, or Christ's blood is necessary for your salvation and eternal life. That when the Bible uses the word blood, that's really, here we go, a metonym, or another name for death. So any place the Bible, especially the New Testament, uses the word blood, referring to the blood of Christ, that it really means the death of Christ. And the teaching is that the blood is not necessary and vital for your salvation, hence your eternal life or your everlasting life. That's what the esteemed Greek scholars say. And they say that you can just take the blood out of the equation and all you have is Christ dying, and that was sufficient to save us from our sins. That is not what the Bible says. Now, let me just kind of help you out. There is a difference between what the Bible actually says and what some people want you to think the Bible means. There's a difference. And when I get to heaven and I'm judged by God, I'm not going to be judged on the basis of what some man tried to tell me the Bible meant. I'm going to be judged, did I believe what it said? And I believe what it says. Let's look at what it says. Acts chapter 20, verse 28. Take heed therefore unto yourselves and to all the flock, over which the Holy Ghost hath made you overseers, to feed the church of God, which he, God, hath purchased with his own blood. Did you see that? Now see, the esteemed scholars who say the blood's really not necessary for salvation, you know, Christ, and here's what they said. This is what made me mad. Christ's blood is simply like any other bodily fluid. Like his sweat or any other thing. And God doesn't have blood. That's not what that verse said. Over which the Holy Ghost hath made you overseers to feed the church of God, which he hath purchased with his own blood. See how simple that is? Now, I know how they get around this. They say, in the original Greek, see, I like it when they do that. In the original Greek, when you read the Greek text of this verse, it really leads you to the idea that it should have been referenced with the blood of his own son. That's what it really should have said. But that's not what it says, is it? No, it's not. God with his own blood. So did God have blood? Yes. And our blood is made in the image, because it's part of our body, and our body is made in the image of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. We are made in that image, and so the image of God is in us, and it's in our blood, and the gospel is in our blood. All right? It's a what's going through my veins right now, making my skin pink, is the testimony of Jesus Christ. I am, you are a living testimony of what Christ does for us in our blood. Romans chapter 5, verse 9. Much more then, being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. It's very specific when it points out that God purchased the church with his own blood and that we are justified by his blood. What that means is that by the blood of Christ, blotting out our sins, now our transgressions are gone. When we get to the white blood cells, I'll show you how that works. Okay? You can go do your own study because it's cool. You'll love it. All right? But anyway, the doctrine is that we cannot be justified with God without Christ's blood. His death, he had to, see, he didn't just hang on the tree. He bled on that tree, the cross. And he had to bleed. If these people who say the blood is not necessary for salvation, then go back to the Old Testament and look at what God told the Levitical priests to do every time they sacrificed an animal. It was always about the blood. It always was, is now, always will be. Ephesians 1:7, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. Ephesians 2:13, but now in Christ Jesus, ye who sometimes were far off are made nigh, how? By the blood of Christ. Colossians 1:14, in whom we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sins. Colossians 1:20, and having made peace through the blood of his cross, by him to reconcile all things unto himself. By him I say, whether they be things in earth or things in heaven. So if we look at these verses, number one, we have redemption through Jesus' blood. We are made nigh by the blood of Christ. We have redemption through his blood. We have had peace between us and God through the blood. It specifically mentions the blood of his cross. Remember when that Roman soldier took that spear and thrust it in Jesus' side? Blood and water. What water? Remember, blood is over half water. Then there's that pericardium, that sack of seawater around the heart. Blood and water issued forth, and it's by the shedding of blood. Without the shedding of blood, the Bible says, there can be no remission of sins. The Bible's simple. Scholars make it hard. Even if we don't understand all the mechanics of how God's blood is applied to our sins and how it provides redemption, there are things we won't understand. There are things, though, that we can believe. All right? Hebrews 9, verse 11. But Christ being come and high priest of good things to come by a greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is to say, not of this building. Think about it. Stop right here. Church buildings are nice. I'm in one now. I'm in the one that I've been in since 1974. Been here practically most of my life. But if this church building were dissolved, my salvation is not. Because God dwells in temples made without man's hands. This is that temple. So if Moses erected a tabernacle, that would have been built by God's hand. God temporarily resided there. But he looks for a permanent dwelling place. That's what Hebrews is all about. Hebrews is all about, yes, there was a covenant in the Old Testament. There is a better covenant now. The word better, you'll find it all through the book of Hebrews. It's the blood of bulls and goats. Yeah, well, that had to be sacrificed every day. A day of atonement had to occur every year to account for the sins committed. there's a better sacrifice with better blood and a better promise and a better temple, a better tabernacle, better spirit. That is the New Testament in Jesus Christ. So, verse 12, neither by the blood of goats and calves, but by his own blood, he entered in once into the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption, not just once a year redemption, eternal redemption for us. For if the blood of bulls and of goats and the ashes of an heifer sprinkling the unclean sanctifieth to the purifying of the flesh, how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God? You see, what he's telling is the Old Testament blood could only clean the flesh. And the law, that was all it would do is clean the flesh. They had a bowl in the tabernacle called the laver, and they would wash before they would go into the most holy place. By the end of the day, next morning, they're dirty again. You got to keep washing, keep washing, keep washing. Christ's blood washes forever. One time, one gift, one salvation, one death of Christ. Not many, as in the Roman Catholic Church, but one sacrifice of Jesus Christ for all of eternity. It's a better covenant made upon better promises and the offering of better blood. Hebrews 12:24, and to Jesus, the mediator of the new covenant, and to the blood of sprinkling that speaketh better things than that of Abel. Think about it. Genesis 4, the gospel. Genesis 4 is the story of Abel. Abel's sacrifices were righteous. Cain's were not. God would not accept Cain's. He accepted Abel's. And who came first, Cain or Abel? Cain did. What covenant came first? Sinai. God rejected Cain's sacrifice. God rejected Sinai for a better sacrifice, Abel's, Christ. And Abel's blood was shed by Cain. Cain spilled his blood. The Bible, you go read Genesis 4, the earth opened her mouth to receive, God told Cain, to receive thy brother's blood at thy hand. And that blood, and God said, Cain, Abel's blood crieth unto me from the ground. That's Abel's blood speaking. Christ's blood, because Christ now is alive, speaks things better than that of Abel. Hebrews 13:20. Now the God of peace that brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, look at it, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 18, for as much as ye know that you were not redeemed with corruptible things, think about the blood of bulls and goats and calves, as silver and gold from your vain conversation received by tradition from your fathers. Verse 19, but with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot. See, to me, and this is what really, it hurt my feelings, because I knew a man in the ministry, looked up to him, that became one of these Greek scholars and wrote in one of these scholarly papers that he no longer believed that the blood of Jesus was the part that cleanses us from our sins and gives us salvation, that was merely his death. And that offended me, because there's nothing more precious to me than Christ's blood sacrifice. Even in a soldier's death, if a soldier is out on the battlefield and he dies for his country, we say that that field contains the hallowed blood of those men who fought and shed their blood for the life of their countrymen. See, we even hallow the blood of soldiers, police officers, who have their blood shed all over the streets of America because they're defending and protecting us while we're asleep at night. We would even say their blood is sacred. How much more the blood of Jesus Christ being precious. And by the way, he said that it is incorruptible. That's what he just said. 1 Peter chapter 1 again. We're not redeemed with corruptible things. If Christ's blood were merely human blood, it would be corruptible. It would vanish away. Christ's blood is what redeems us, and it's as incorruptible as this word is. All right? 1 John 1:7. But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another. And the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanseth us from all sin. How much? All of it. One sacrifice. I mentioned the Catholic Church. Let me explain that so I don't want to offend somebody. Let me just tell you the truth. The truth is, and if you're a Catholic, you know this. Every single time the Roman priest does the ceremony of the Mass, it is said that he is crucifying Jesus Christ all over again. He is breaking his body and he is spilling his blood, crucifying Christ all over again. How many Catholic churches, monasteries, convents all over the world do this every single day? Thousands. Thousands of times every single day. The teaching of the Roman Church is we have to sacrifice. It's called the sacrifice of the Mass. We have to sacrifice Jesus all over again so you can have salvation. And they tell you, you have to keep coming back to receive the Eucharist. And if you don't, then you're at risk of either going to purgatory or going to hell. That's Catholic doctrine. The doctrine of the Bible says, no. He's not sacrificed again, 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 again. One offering, one sacrifice, one time, for all of eternity. That's how you know that it's God's own Son and God's own blood being spilled and shed for your redemption. Revelation 1:5, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness and the first begotten of the dead and the prince of the kings of the earth, unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood. Now, again, I kind of struggled with the idea that we have our robes, or let's say ourselves, washed in the blood of Christ, and now we're white and clean. That never worked in my house. If I got blood coming out of my nose and it got all over my shirt and pants when I was a boy, I'd throw them away or just use them for play clothes, all right? Because that blood staining, mom never get it out. So how does blood make garments white? Probably won't get there today, but I'm going to show you that. I love it. But he's washed us from our sins in his own blood. And so what we're going to do is we're going to show you how blood works and what it does. What do these red blood cells do? Why are they red? What do they look like? What do the white blood cells do? How do they work? You're going to see that. Let's look at red blood cells. I want you to notice red blood cells, and see here again, we didn't know this as a people, as humans. We didn't know this for thousands of years. We knew that blood was red. Yeah, we've seen lots of blood. People have been shedding blood for all of eternity. But nobody knew why the blood was red. Nobody knew what made up red blood until they invented the microscope back in the 1800s. And then people started peering down through these lenses and they were trying to look at very small things that nobody had ever seen before. And they were able to see bacteria, germs. They were actually able to see the very seed of man. Nobody had ever seen that before. Nobody knew what that was. Now we're able to see it. Then they started looking at blood. I can remember this. I remember my mom or my dad, one of the two, they got me one of those microscope kits at a yard sale. And I mean, it had the microscope, it had slides in there. I mean, it had the whole works in there. And I'm going, this is cool. And I'd pick a sore and put blood on there and I'd run it in there and I'd be looking at my blood and I'd be going, that is so cool. for the first time in the world, we started looking at blood and we noticed that the red blood cells, take a look at this, their shape. What is that? It's a cup. The shape of red blood cells is a cup, a bowl, a platter. It's that way for a reason. It's because the red blood cells, here's what they do. They're shaped like a cup because they carry things. And I'm going to show you what the red blood cells carry in them. If you're going to carry something, you got to have a bowl, you got to have a cup, a platter of some kind to hold it in. And that's what red blood cells are. So, and I mean, I pulled up, I was going to sit down and start this. This is about a year ago. And I thought, you know, I'm going to learn about blood. I want to do something on blood, Lord. You show me about blood. Show me some things I don't know about blood and show it to me from the Bible. And I started doing the research and I looked at a red blood cell and I went, it looks like a cup. And I went, there are verses in the Bible. Mark chapter 14, look at it. Verse 23, he took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and they all drank of it. And he said unto them, this is, look at it, this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many. He says in another one of the gospel writers, he said, this is the New Testament in my blood. It's in his blood, which means there's something about the gospel of grace and the new covenant, and it's in his blood, and it can be in his blood because the red blood cells are shaped like cups that hold things. And it holds things that give us life. The word erythrocyte, which is the proper scientific name for red blood cells, from the Greek, erythros, which means red, and ketos, for like a hollow vessel, with the word site translated as cell in modern usage. So basically, it's a red, hollow vessel shaped cell is what it is. That's what the word erythrocyte means. I love Greek. I love these etymologies. All right, so we have red blood cells. Jesus said, this is the New Testament in my blood, and he had a cup in his hand. Red blood cells look like a cup. So what is it these cups carry? They carry something. They carry life to the body. And think about it. Think about your body, your physical body, but then think of the body of the believers of Jesus Christ. Everybody who is saved, who is born again, everybody who loves the Lord and keeps his word, we are all members, different members, but members nonetheless of the body of Jesus Christ. And as our blood and our red blood cells, shaped like cups, these vessels, carry life-giving things to the body, so does the blood of Christ and his spirit through the blood, giving life to all the believers. I'm going to show you how that works. Genesis chapter 2, verse 7. Here's what those cups carry. The Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. Now I want you to think about that. God blew breath into Adam. His body was laying there and it was lifeless. God then breathed into Adam, and Adam became a living soul. What does air going into our mouth and lungs do? Does it just fill up the lungs and stay there? No. That oxygen in that air, remember how the heart is made. One chamber of the heart pulls blood in from the body. Blood that has been depleted of its oxygen and been loaded up, because these cups not only carry things to, they carry things from the body. Okay, I'll show you that. Anyway, the blood comes in that chamber sends it to the next chamber, which sends it to the lungs. The lungs then fill that blood with more oxygen. So these cups, the first thing they're doing is that they're carrying oxygen, which my brain needs it, all of my cells need it, every part of my body needs oxygen. My mom used to just freak out when she'd see a rubber band around my wrist. Remember those days? Get that off your wrist. Why? because you're going to rot your hand off. And I kept going, Mom, I'm pretty sure that when the pain and the gangrene sets in, I'll take the rubber band off. You know how moms are, right? But what happens? You're depriving the cells and the tissues in your hand, when they put a tourniquet or whatever, you're depriving them of oxygen. And those red blood cells are shaped like cups because they're carrying the spirit. It's the blood that carries the spirit. No blood, no spirit. That's how it works. Job 33:4, the Spirit of God hath made me, and the breath of the Almighty hath given me life. John 6:63, it is the Spirit that quickeneth, the flesh profiteth nothing. The words, look at this, the words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. Psalm 33:6, by the word of the Lord were the heavens made, and all the host of them by the breath of his mouth. Think about it. The words that I'm speaking to you right now, how's that possible? I mean, what's the science here? Every word that I speak is based upon breath. No breath, no words. The breath coming out of my lungs, going past my vocal cords, they're vibrating to give the highs and the lows. And then my mouth, my teeth, my tongue, my lips, some people, their nose, they're shaping the wind that's coming up from the lungs. And they're giving it substance. So instead of me just sitting here for an hour and a half going, amen. No, God's given us the ability to take that breath and to form it and to shape it and to do things with it to give words. And what I'm telling you is that as the lungs give that oxygen through these red blood cells to the whole body, transferring it to the body, we need it. The breath of God is actually His Word. All Scripture is given by inspiration. See, there's the word spira there. That's a Latin part of it. The Greek word's pneuma, like pneumonia, pneumatic tools. It all has to do with wind and breath. Jesus said, the words that I speak unto you, they are spirit. By the word of the Lord, by the breath of His mouth. If breath comes out of God's mouth, I guarantee you, it's shaped in the form of words. Don't let anybody tell you that the Spirit of God is something besides the written record of the Word of God. But that's what the life, that's what the breath does, goes into our lungs, the red blood cells. Take a look at this picture. Let me explain this picture. I put this together because I was going to go to Kenya right after our homecoming last year. God didn't let me do it. I got to the airport. They turned us back. Immigration, whatever, the grandchildren's passports were going to expire, and there's a six-month thing, and we weren't able to go. But I wanted so bad to teach this to those beautiful Kenyan people over there and in their churches, because, listen to me, it doesn't matter where you are in this world, who you are in this world, what physical church building you go into or walk out of. If you are the body of the believers of Jesus Christ, when you breathe in, take in that air, and your blood is passing through those lungs, grabbing those oxygen cells, oxygen molecules. When the right lung breathes in air, where does the right lung blood go to? Only the right side of the body? The left side of the body? No. Blood comes in, blood goes out of the heart, and it goes to the whole body. There is no difference. And just because you're a Christian in America, or born-again believer in Africa, or Korea, Japan, anywhere on the planet, when God breathes through His Word, the Spirit, the blood of the New Testament, Christ's blood, carries that life and breathes into all the churches. All the members of the body receive the benefit and the blessing of the Spirit of God, the breath of God, and the Word of God. It's the blood, people, that is bringing us the Word of God. I love that. Romans 8:10. And if Christ be in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the Spirit, there it is life because of righteousness. You got to have the Spirit. You got to have the breath. 2 Corinthians 3:6. Who also hath made us able ministers of the New Testament, not of the letter, but of the Spirit. For the letter killeth, but the Spirit giveth life. Stop right here. I had to show you something. Friend of mine, Chuck Thurston, ER doctor. He's the guy, years ago, we were both doing things for Noah Hutchings, Southwest Radio, and we got to talking, and his sense of humor is kind of like mine, and we just cracked up jokes for a long time. Anyway, I love the man. But anyway, he's the guy that introduced me to the idea that the wilderness tabernacle and the human cell were the same thing. The cell nucleus is the most holy place where the DNA is stored. That's where the book of the law is, all right? The curtain around the tabernacle, around the court, that was the cell wall. And I'm just going, okay, that's pretty cool. And then that started my study some 16 years ago, all right? But anyway, he brought this up to me, and I like it. This verse says that we are able ministers of the New Testament, not of the letter, but of the Spirit. For the letter killeth, but the Spirit giveth life. The Old Testament was written in Hebrew. Did you know that in Hebrew, there's only one letter in all of the Hebrew alphabet that's actually a vowel, and it's Aleph. The rest of the Hebrew letters are like Beth, Daleth, Gimel, whatever. I don't know all of them. Psalm 119 has them all listed. You know they're all consonants? I want you to think about it. Consonants are the letters like K, T, B, M, N, Z. They require the tongue, the lips, the teeth, and with some people, the nasal passages. They require stopping the air in order to make the sound, like the letter T. I had to stop the breath coming out of my mouth. And it exploded out. That's the letter T. The letter has no air in it, but the Spirit giveth life. So here, this whole Old Testament, written in mostly consonants, it's the letter of the law with no life in it. It killeth. The Spirit giveth life. So then God said, stammering lips, Moses, Old Testament, Hebrew, and another tongue will he speak to this people, Greek. Greek actually has vowels written in. They actually have vowels in the alphabet. Alpha, Omega, Iota, Upsilon, Epsilon, Eta. Did I get all of them? I'm trying to remember. Those are just breath sounds. That's what gives us life. Amen. Galatians 6:8. For he that soweth to his flesh shall of the flesh reap corruption, but he that soweth to the Spirit shall of the Spirit reap everlasting life. Now watch this, Ezekiel 37. I love this. Because remember, we're looking at the gospel in the body, the gospel in our blood. Watch this. Remember them bones, them dry bones? Ezekiel 37, watch this. So I prophesied as I was commanded, and as I prophesied there was a noise, and behold, a shaking. The bones came together, bone to his bone. And when I beheld, lo, the sinews and the flesh came up upon them. And the skin covered them above, but there was no what? No breath in them. Then said he unto me, prophesy unto the wind. Prophesy, son of man, and say to the wind, thus saith the Lord God, come from the, how many winds? Four. O breath, and breathe upon these slain, that they may live. Remember, the breath of God is the words of God, that they may live. So I prophesied as he commanded me, and the breath came into them, and they lived and stood upon their feet, an exceeding great army. Do you see the gospel here? How many winds did Ezekiel have to prophesy? Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. That's where the cup of the New Testament in his blood is taught and shown us. Isn't that beautiful? You know, this prophecy of Israel, right? And yes, Israel, they're a nation once again. But they're still reading the Old Testament, and there's a veil over it when they read it. They don't understand it. They don't know who the Messiah is. They're still looking for him. One of these days, the Son of Man is going to preach Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John to those beautiful people of Israel. Right now, Israelites, especially the religious ones, they're pretty wicked. They're worshiping a false god through the Kabbalah. But one of these days, the wind, the breath, the four winds, the gospel is going to be preached and prophesied to them. And that's going to go by way of the blood of Jesus Christ into their body and give them life. Hallelujah. Not only is the four gospels and the gospel itself in our blood, it's a prophecy of those things to come. Now take a look at this picture, all right? Because we have the red blood cell shaped like a cup. And so the first thing that it carries is the breath. It pulls it in from the lungs, remember, and it pulls the oxygen, from that fresh oxygen that you breathe in from the lungs, puts it in those cups, and those cups go to all parts of the body and says, here, take this, take this, take this. All parts of my body, my brain, getting those good oxygen-rich things in them that gives me life. But the blood cells, the red blood cells, they're not done. They actually are carrying more than just oxygen to the cells. Take a look at it, the digestive system. This guy, he's fixing to eat an apple, and this little chart is showing you the apple's going to go in his mouth, going to drop down into his stomach, down into his bowels, and what's going to happen there? What happens once either food or water goes into the bowels? What happens? Somehow, some way, that food is broken down into its smallest parts, converted into sugar, and then delivered to all the cells of the body. How? The bowl, the cup, the wheelbarrow, the red blood cells shaped like a cup carry both oxygen, get ready for this one, and sugar to all the cells. Why? What does the cell do with the oxygen and the sugar once it gets it? And for that matter, how does it get in there? See, I had to learn this. Several years ago, I came down pretty sick and had no strength in me at all. Lots of problems going on. Went to the doctor. He did a simple test. Little stick on my finger, showed me the number. It was close to 400. The blood sugar level in my, the sugar level in my blood, close to 400. He said, it's a good thing you're here today. He said, gets to 400, that's when people start going into comas. That scared me. That scared me. I can say now, after having the weight loss and everything like that, my body reacts to sugar a lot better than it did back in those days. But see, what I did was, I wanted to know. My dad was diabetic. He was usually two or three shots a day. He was very brittle diabetic. And I watched him give himself shots of insulin over and over and over again. And I never really thought much about what insulin does and how it affects the blood sugar levels. Then I started looking at it. And I went, because I know what a cell is. A cell in my body is a picture of the tabernacle that Moses built. The cell wall is the curtain. The nucleus is the most holy place. The nucleus is where the DNA is stored, and that's where the book of the law went, the Ark of the Covenant. All right? There's also other things inside the curtain of the tabernacle, inside the cell wall of the cell. There's something else in there very, very important to giving us life. In the tabernacle, outside of the most holy place, the sanctuary, was an altar. Not like, you know, the altar benches we have in our church. It was this square, had four corners on it, had a ash pan underneath, it had a little grating thing there, and they built a fire and they burnt sacrifices every day. There were sacrifices in that altar burning away. What does it take to light a fire? Okay, I want you to think about that. Let me get back. Let me step back a little bit. Where did these priests, these Levite priests, get all this stuff that they were burning on there? And what was it that they were burning? Could people bring in rocks and pieces of iron for sacrifices to burn on the altar? No. Why? It's because it couldn't be burnt. Doesn't have any. Doesn't have any DNA. Everything that the Israelites brought for the priest to burn on the altar had been alive at one point. It had DNA in it, like goats and calves, bulls, even birds, fine flour, olive oil, things like that. Those were all things that at one time had DNA in them, and they were alive, and they were brought. Actually, they were all things that when they brought to the Levite priests, see, the Levite priests weren't allowed to have any land, so they didn't own cattle, and they didn't own goats, and they didn't grow crops. They just tended to the service of the Lord, but they got to eat. So God, every day, had the Israelites bringing them sacrifices that they could eat. Meat from goats and bulls and calves and birds and fine flour and olive oil. I mean, good stuff. They were fed well. Think about it. What was it, technically, that they were burning on the altar? Food. You've got a thing in your cell called mitochondria. You know what it does? Burns. Burns food you eat. Let me show you how this works. Take a look at this. So here's a picture on the bottom of a little boy bringing the Levite priest, and he's very happy, he's got a smile, and he's going to bring that little lamb to the Levite priest. I want you to notice behind the man there to the right standing there that the curtain is closed and only the Levite priest can open that up. Stop right here. I want you to think about that. The regular Israelites, let's say from Naphtali and Gad and Judah and Reuben and Simeon and those other tribes, they were not allowed to go inside that sanctuary, that tabernacle. They were forbidden. Only the Levite priest could. And when people brought their sacrifices with fine flour, oil, or animal sacrifices, they were not allowed to just go right in, throw it on the altar themselves. Oh, no. God built a curtain around that thing and told everybody, keep out. Only the Levites can do this. So I got to studying insulin. I found out what it did. Insulin in your blood travels through your blood and it goes to all the cells. And insulin, take a look at this, okay? In your cell, there are what's called insulin receptors. And those little things there in your cell wall, insulin reacts to them and causes the cell wall to do one thing. Open up. Once the cell wall, just like the curtain there in that graphic, once the cell wall opens up, sugar then goes into that cell, and then that cell wall closes. Now it has the sugar in it. What does insulin do? It opens the cell, just like the Levite priest opening the curtain to receive the sacrifice, the food in it, so it can be burnt on the altar. I looked at that and I went, my insulin are my Levite priests that open up the tabernacle to take the food in, the sugar. And what I found out was, I was 300 pounds. My dad had diabetes. And what happens is my weight was inhibiting two things. Number one, my body's ability to produce enough insulin. So that's bad enough. Number two, the insulin that was there, the weight of my body was keeping the insulin from doing its job. So I had to take a medicine that, number one, squeezed more insulin out of my, where it comes from, on the pancreas. And number two, it helped it do its job. What I had was not enough Levite priests in me, and the ones that I had were lazy. They didn't do anything. So what would happen is, while my cells are needing that sugar, the Levite priests are not opening up, they're closing the way. And that sugar then builds up in my blood. And then it starts doing damage to tissues because it's trying to get into the cells. And the cells are not opening up because the priests aren't there to open it up. And the sugar just pounds on the cell walls and it does damage. That's why diabetics are at risk for losing their eyesight or having damage under their heart or any number of things. Why? Because the sugar is actually just trying to ram its way in, and the priests aren't there to let it in to do its job. That's what I found out. And think about it. The whole point of the Levite priest system was for what? To point to the sacrifice of Jesus Christ as the Lamb of God. See, it's the gospel, isn't it? It's the gospel is in your blood. Take a look at this. Now think about it. This whole process is about converting the things that we eat, food, and converting that into energy. Energy equals light. Look at Psalm 119:130. The entrance of thy words giveth light. Bulls have DNA, which is the words that God made them out of, the book of life. Goats, calves, doves, flour. Flour is wheat seed or corn seed or whatever that's been ground up into fine flour. Olive oil. Olives are the fruit that's on the olive tree. They all had DNA. When we eat in our bodies, we don't eat spoons and forks and toothpicks. Well, toothpicks had DNA in them, but you get the idea. We don't eat the plate that's made of ceramic, stone, or plastic, or whatever. We don't eat the forks and the spoons because they didn't have life. They didn't have DNA. We eat things that have DNA. Meat and cheese and vegetables and olive oil and corn oil and things like that is what we eat. And the entrance of those words that God put in those creatures, those plants go into our body and it gives us light, because whenever you light a fire, I mean, we even use the term light the fire. What are we saying? Ignite the fire somehow, some way. And when fire comes on, what does it give off? Heat and light. Same process. Think about it. When they brought in the DNA packed bull, goat, calf, turtle dove, wheat, olive oil, and put it on the altar, they were bringing in things that had God's word. The entrance of God's words through those sacrifices led upon the altar. And when those things were burnt, they gave off two things, actually three things. We're going to look at two things primarily: heat and light. Even in the candlestick, the sanctuary, it was to be fueled by what? Olive oil, which had DNA in it. Okay, the entrance of thy words giveth light. So here's how it works in the cell. Think about this. My body right now, I'm doing pretty good today. My temperature probably of my body would be about 98.6. That's the average human temperature. It fluctuates a little bit depending on, you know, spring, summer, winter, things like that, or whether you're sick, whether you're exercising, sitting still, whatever. Anyway, it's 98.6. How does it get that? Where does your body get its internal heat? It gets it when the insulin receptors trigger the opening of the cell. The cell takes in that sugar and that oxygen, because you cannot light a fire in a vacuum. Let me put it to you like this: where there is no spirit, there will be no fire and there will be no light. It has to be there. So the cells opened up. Now we have oxygen in the cell. Now we have sugar in the cell. We have everything in there to build a nice little fire in our cell. And so the mitochondria of your cell, there's a picture of it, takes in the sugar and the oxygen, and it burns it. And that burning process gives off heat, light, and energy, because that's what fire is. It's pure energy. See how, do you see it now? How the gospel of in the Levite priest, their foreshadowing of Christ and his sacrifice, it's in our blood. It's in our cells. The testimony of Jesus Christ lives and abides in us. Now here's what was really cool to me. Because I grew up and we had a wood stove in our house. Not a wood cook stove, but a wood heating stove. You know, we were one of those people that in January, when it's 5 degrees below zero Fahrenheit outside, we were opening the doors and windows of our house because the wood stove got it too hot, okay? Got to cool the house down in the middle of January. And I would go get wood, and I would put wood in the wood stove. And sometimes I'd get cold and go stand by it. And then every 3 or 4 days, something like that, my mom or my dad would say, Mike, take the ash pan out. And the bottom of our wood stove was an ash pan. Why? Because when we would burn wood in our stove, it would burn all of that stuff off. Smoke that comes up, do you know what smoke is for the most part? Carbon remains of something that's burnt. Do you know what ashes are? The carbon remains of something that's burnt. We are a carbon-based life form. Carbon is the base of who we are. Carbon is the base of like wood. And when all of that is burned off, either in the smoke or in the ashes, it's carbon. That's what ashes are. So just as there was a process, I'm going to show you this. There was a process by which the Levite priest had to carry out the ashes out of the altar complex. Guess what? There's a process by which once the oxygen and the sugar is burnt in your cell, guess what remains in there? Carbon. When you breathe in, you're taking that rich oxygen, it's delivering it to the cells. What happens when it's burnt? The remains of it are carbon. Where does it have to go? This is why it comes out our breath. The heart delivers it back to the lungs. That carbon is emitted out of our lungs. When we breathe out, we're blowing out the trash. We breathe in, we're bringing in the good, we're blowing out the trash. The carbon's what we're doing. You cannot breathe your own breath for too long. You'll pass out. You're depriving your body of oxygen and you're loading it up with carbon and your body's trying to get rid of the carbon because it's not good. It can't stay in there. It's not good. So look at this. The remains of the fire on the altar is ashes. Ashes equal carbon. Remains of burning sugar in the cell equal carbon. Take a look at this. Here's how it works. See on the right side there where the vein is, the venule, that rich oxygenated blue blood goes through these capillaries. And in those capillaries, there's the exchange. Remember, the red blood cell is carrying all this because it looks like a cup. The red blood cell carries the oxygen through the capillaries to the cells, and the cells then take in the oxygen and then put out the carbon back into the blood, which is fed not back through the veins, to the artery. The artery then takes it back up to the heart. The heart then takes it to the lungs and passes the carbon out in our breath. We blow it out every time we breathe. Man, it's so cool. CO2, right? Carbon dioxide is poisonous if we take in too much. We'll pass out. We need oxygen. We need to get rid of the carbon. And that's what happens. Same process in the cell and in the tabernacle. Let me show you something. This is cool. Here's a picture on the left. Blood full of oxygen. The picture on the right is blood full of carbon. You see a difference. Now watch this. Remember, oxygen-rich blood going through the veins to the cells, the capillaries. Capillaries are dumping the oxygen off. And as that same red blood cell dumps the oxygen off, it picks up the carbon. Now it's changed its appearance. I gotta show you this. I did not know this until I went looking in the scriptures and I found out. Let me read it. Leviticus 6:10. The priest shall put on his linen garment, and his linen breeches shall he put upon his flesh, and take up the ashes which the fire hath consumed with the burnt offering on the altar, and he shall put them beside the altar. Verse 11. And he shall put off his garments, and put on other garments, and carry forth the ashes without the camp unto a clean place. Did you see that? The priest that's attending the altar, when he picks the ashes up, he has to change his appearance by putting on different garments. And then he can take the ashes outside of the tabernacle and take them and dispose of them in a clean place. And then think about what God does. God is so cool. God takes all that carbon dioxide that we're blowing into the air, and trees and leafy greens and vegetation, well, that's what they eat. They eat all the carbon that we're blowing into the air, and then what do? They take the carbon out and blow out of their leaves clean oxygen. That's how we're able to keep breathing on this. This just blesses my heart. I saw that and I'm going, even the Levite priest changed his appearance before he took the ashes outside of the tabernacle and put them in a clean place. Just like the blood changes his appearance from that oxygen-rich blue, and it dumps off the oxygen, the red blood cells dump off the oxygen, and the red blood cells pick up the carbon remains of what's been burnt on the mitochondria and takes it and dispels it out of the lungs into a clean place. You see the gospel? Let me put it to you like this. Evolutionists want you to believe that we came about as a result of millions of genetic accidents. I don't believe that. When I see stuff like this in the Bible, God clearly with his law dictated how all of this was to be done in the priesthood and in the tabernacle. Moses wrote it out in the law and said, this is how we're going to do it. By the way, inside your nucleus is a full copy of your DNA. Okay, the instruction manual of your body, right? Did you know there's a secondary copy of your mother's DNA outside of the nucleus? It's called mitochondrial DNA. It's attached to the mitochondria, the altar. You know what it does? You know what mitochondrial DNA does? It regulates what the cell does and how it does it. Just like the copy of the law regulated what the Levite priest did and how they did it. And when the priests don't do what they're supposed to do, it always brought death to the body of the Israelites. Always did. Just like me. I mean, I could have very easily died. I felt bad for a while. Knew something was wrong. And I didn't know what. I could have easily died because the insulin was not working in my body. My Levite priest had gone to sleep. And there just wasn't enough of them around. And I was building toxic sugar up in my blood system. Thank God that I'm better off now than I was 4 years ago. Well, let me ask you this question. We're gonna stop right here. Next week, we'll talk about white blood cells, platelets. You don't want to miss that. Let me ask you this. Examine your life right now. You might be listening to this and somebody handed you a DVD or sent you to YouTube or whatever, and you're watching this and you kind of believe in God, but you don't think about him much. Do you see now how much God has designed you and the workings of your body that we don't even pay attention to, and yet God orders them to be done a certain way, and most of the time it works in us. Do you see how God made you in His image according to this book? And He gives us all the beautiful instructions in this Bible that match our... I'm just getting started on showing you how much of your body I found in the Bible, and I'm not done studying. Let me ask you a question. 4 years ago, that diabetes took a hold of me, and I was pretty close to danger with the blood sugar levels in my body. I can truly say, by the grace of God, that I'm better off than I was 4 years ago. And I'm going to ask you the same question. Today, right now, are you better off than you were a year ago, 5 years ago, 10 years ago, 20 years ago? Knowing that God made you in a particular fashion, and that making of you, we see it right here in His Word. Don't you think that God has a purpose for your life? Don't you believe that God wants you to believe in Him and believe in His Word and trust that as your body needs to get rid of certain things, things that are dead, the burnt remains of whatever, maybe God wants to give you a different life and change your life. I believe that He can by way of what Jesus did as recorded for us in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Christ died so that we could live. And when I show you the white blood cell next week, you'll know it, because it's a perfect picture of Christ on the cross. It's so wonderful. I can't wait. But you have to ask yourself, where is my life right now with Jesus Christ? You know, it's real simple. Whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. You call unto God, I believe God will find a way of showing you whether or not you're saved or not. All right? You just call on Him and ask Him. God will show you. All right, this is Pastor Mike. I love doing this. We're going to pick it up, try to finish off the blood next week. We'll see you next week then. Bye-bye.